Hello, and welcome to this short session on using the Sarvis and Mindroom Centre's new digital resource, Future Me, to support young people in the transition to adulthood. My name is Andrew Wright. I'm a children and young people outreach specialist, working as part of the direct help and support team at the Sarvis and Mindroom Centre. My role specifically is to support young people to self-advocate when plans are being developed for their transition. In this session, I'll begin by giving you some background information on the development of Future Me, and we'll briefly consider why it's important that young people have a voice in their transition planning before we take a look at the resource itself and some of the activities within it. Sarvis and Mindroom Centre is a charity that works across the whole of Scotland. We want all children and young people with learning difficulties to lead a fulfilling life, and we support them and their families to achieve this. We inform and provide evidence-based procedures and tools to help families and professionals with the goal of empowering children, young people, and their families with the skills and confidence to have a real say in decisions about their lives. From its inception, Sarvis and Mindroom Centre has placed the child or young person and their family at the centre of all that we do. There are likely, of course, to be many people and organisations involved in their lives, and there'll be many processes that affect them. So ensuring the child or young person is always kept at the centre is at the very heart of the way that we work. I joined the team in 2018 to develop a project that addressed a specific issue for young people with learning difficulties as they approached the end of their schooling. Evidence demonstrated these young people often missed out on the valuable experience of a work placement, and in their situations, the needs and limitations of the system appeared to regularly take precedence over the needs of them as individuals. We developed a very successful and effective model and worked with schools across the southeast of Scotland to support young people with a wide range of interests to enjoy relevant and meaningful work placements. One of the things we found when we reviewed the placements was that increased confidence and self-esteem were common benefits to the young people that took part. Something that I certainly had not expected, however, was that this was the case for many of these young people, even when, for whatever reason, the work placement itself was either cut short or a suitable placement wasn't found at all. We put the reason for this down to that core principle of ensuring that the young person was kept at the centre. I would typically have spent 8 to 12 hours before any of the placements discussing with the young person their interests and skills, and then considering together how these might help them in whatever it was they wanted to do in the future. But work placements, of course, are just one experience in a much bigger picture for young people as they approach the end of schooling. And with 2020's lockdown, it was clear finding suitable work placements for any young person was going to be off the cards. So we decided to broaden our scope and to look more at that bigger picture. We knew ourselves from calls to our helpline and from the young people we worked with in that supported work placement project, that the whole transition process for young people with additional support needs could be somewhat hit and miss. We'd also seen for ourselves that when you sit down with a young person and talk with them about what they're good at and what they want for themselves, it can be transformative. The Scottish Transitions Forum's report, Facing the Future Together, as well as their publication, principles of good transitions 3 both say similar things. They set out a benchmark for what should be in place for young people at this stage in their lives. Now, a really good example of best practice in this area is person-centered planning. This is a methodology that helps develop a plan based on a person's own hopes and aspirations. It begins by naming their big dream before moving on to set realistic targets that might help them move closer to that dream. It grounds this in where the person is right now, considers who will support them to achieve what it is they want for themselves, and what skills and qualities they have that are going to help. And then finally, what definite actions all of those involved can take to reach the targets that have been set. Now, there are clearly significant parallels here with the work that we developed ourselves in the supported work placement project. So where does all of this bring us? Well, we've got this knowledge of the importance of comprehensive transition planning involving the young person. There's our own long-standing principle of keeping the child or young person and their family at the centre. There are the insights from our supported work placement project and from person-centred planning. And of course, there are the core principles embedded in the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, in particular in Article 12, which deals with the importance of children and young people being involved in decisions about their lives. So let's just take a quick look at that. Article 12 is on the right to be listened to and taken seriously. It says children and young people have the human right to have opinions, and for these opinions to be heard and taken seriously, with their evolving capacities taken into account. And by that, we mean that their reasoned ability to make decisions is going to be affected by the decision that they're making in the stage of life that they're at. But the child's view always needs to be taken seriously whenever it's heard, because it can change what an adult considers to be in that child's best interests. And it does that by giving that adult a better idea of what's important to the child and what that child might consider distressing, for example. So children and young people should be given the information they need to make good decisions. They should feel able to express their opinions, and they need to know that they have this right so that they can exercise it. But also, adults need to know about the right so they don't dismiss it out of hand. So back then to our collection of experience, insights, and guiding principles. What we did is we pulled all of this information and experience together, and we used that to develop Future Me, a digital online resource that helps a young person to reflect with a trusted adult on what they want for themselves in the future. These views can then be used to inform formal transition planning where that's happening. But I should point out, Future Me is not itself a transition plan. The resource has been developed with young people who have learning difficulties in mind, but actually we believe it can be of use to all young people. There are 12 sections within it, comprising 40 different activities. As well as some reflective activities to help a young person consider their own strengths and their hopes for the future, there are activities that provide a starting point for further discussion and exploration together on the more practical aspects of life as an adult. So let's take a quick look at what these 12 sections are before we have a look at the resource and how you can access it yourselves. Section one sets the scene. It takes a look at what has brought the young person to where they are today before moving on to consider that big dream. In section two, we look at how things are for the young person now before thinking about their skills and qualities in sections three and four. Section five is based largely on what we developed through the supported work placement project. It helps the young person to think about how their skills and qualities might be helpful in the world of work in the future. And then section six reflects on what education and training they already have and what they might need, both academic and from out with formal education. In section seven, the young person's encouraged to think about how well equipped they are for living independently, whether there are any specific skills they might want to develop. Sections eight and nine are on finance and legal matters. These are intentionally brief. They provide starting points for further discussion where it's relevant and where that's appropriate to the young person. In section 10, the skills involved in self-travel are explored. This is an area that, for many young people with additional support needs, there's a need for some specific skill development. And then finally, section 11 provides a framework for planning the next steps before section 12 allows you to create a summary of what the young person wants. And there's a template for them to record any relevant opinions and information that they might want to share. So let's take a look now then at the resource itself. And you can see here that the resource is accessed through a web browser. We recommend using Google Chrome because the functionality of the resource works most smoothly within that environment. On the first page, there is that summary of all the sections. These are individually clickable, so you can jump to whichever section is relevant to the young person you're working with. There's also a user guide that you can download, and this contains lots of helpful hints and tips on how to work together through it. The resource has very simple and straightforward navigation. This is all held at the very top of each screen. Now, you can't see all of it because of where my video is placed, unfortunately, but there is a menu icon, a help icon, a back one page arrow, home page, an arrow to take you forward a page, and an arrow to print. This is how you save your progress. You can either print on paper, or there's the option to print to a PDF, and this will save what you've done on each screen. So we recommend that that's what you do as you work through the resource together. Let's take a look then at this menu. This is available at any time and contains an overview of everything within the resource, each section and each of the activities within it. So if we click on this first one, Life's Journey So Far, let's have a look at that. This is where we recommend you always begin. Before moving on to think about the big dream, it's helpful to look back at what's brought you where you are today. And so we invite the young person to think about their life so far and to pick out five milestones, five things that are significant to them in whatever way. They could be positive things, they could be negative. If they are negative, then we would recommend you don't dwell on them, but use them as an opportunity to reinforce the positives. The young person has, for instance, moved on from whatever that experience was. These milestones can be recorded simply by typing into these boxes here. And then when you've done that, up at the top of the page, print to a PDF to save your progress. If we then move on to the next activity, you can see we're leaving the past behind us and dreaming about what the future might be. This is not in any way grounded in reality. It's simply an opportunity for the young person to think what, in their wildest dreams, they would like for the future. There are some tips here that give questions that might be helpful in discussing this with them. And the cloud here is a space to record what that dream might be. Let's go back to the menu then. And in section two, we're looking at where the in-person is now, what their world is like. One of the activities is this one on what they do. There's an overview of the week there, as well as quite a large selection of icons that can be dragged and dropped anywhere onto the page. So they might say, for instance, that they like to phone a friend on a Saturday evening. They maybe go swimming on Saturday afternoons and enjoy going for a walk on a Sunday morning. Perhaps they enjoy gaming on Friday nights and Thursday nights, and they go to school throughout the week. You can drag as many of these icons as you need across the week. As well as the icons, there's space to type whatever you want to into each of these boxes. So you can build up together a picture of what is in the young person's life and what they enjoy. The process of doing that is much more important than the actual recording itself. So don't worry too much about what the page ends up looking like and what's actually there. And then once that's completed yet again, we go to the top of the screen and we print to a PDF to save it for future reference. So back to the menu. Section three, we're looking at skills. Skills types is one of the things that we encourage them to look at. This is based on information from the SCQF. But as well as that, if we go back a page, we ask them to think about all of the skills that they actually have. And we've divided these into different categories. So for instance, if we were to choose cognitive skills, their thinking skills, we're going to ask them how good they are at planning. If you click on the question here at the end, here's a prompt at the bottom. How good are you at thinking ahead, working out all of the different things that will need to be achieving something? Now, this is not an opportunity for them to say, I'm no good at that. If they do feel this is something they're not good at, you can move on to the question of, well, what helps you? And make sure that what you record is always positive. That way we build up a big picture of a really positive person with lots of skills and attributes. On this particular tab, you're going to be thinking about problem solving, about memory. So here again, how well do you retain information? And are there things that help you to do this? Similarly with their concentration skills, how well can they focus on something and what can help? After you've completed each tab, that needs to be saved before you work on another one. This is something that will probably take quite some time to work through. Certainly in my experience with the young people I've worked with, this does take a considerable amount of time and a lot of conversation. And that's what it's all about. So after looking at skills, we're going to be looking at qualities together, how they deal with feelings, how they like people to respond to their feelings, what kind of personality they have. Now, when you're looking at this, there's a questionnaire that you can download and give to other people who know the young person and get some input from them as well, which can reinforce those positives and be really affirming. You're going to be asking the young person to think about when they think people see them at their best and what they would say they were like when they are at their best. What makes them feel most alive? What gives them most energy? And how do they think they make a positive difference to people who are around them? Notice that's not do you make a positive difference, but it's how do you make a positive difference? So again, we're always focusing on positives. In section five, the career plan is based pretty much on the work we did in the supported work placement project and helps the young person to think about these dreams, their skills, their qualities, and how they're going to apply potentially to a career in the future. What is their dream job, for instance, and how are their strengths, their key skills, going to help them with that? education and training comes next before we look at independent living skills. Let's take a look at this section briefly. Each section does begin with a title page like this, gives them a brief overview. So here we're going to be looking at their rights and responsibilities, as well as how they might become more independent. If we move on a page, this starts by asking them to brainstorm what they think other people do for them in terms of money or in terms of their education and their well-being. Once they've brainstormed that, we continue and ask them to look at those lists and for each one, again, using icons to name the things that they can do on their own, they might need help with, things that they think they could learn to do for themselves, and maybe there are some things that they think they're always going to need some help with. After that, we're going to move on to get more specific. Quite a list here of very specific independent living skills, and for each one, a brief summary, and we ask the young person to rate themselves on a score of 1 to 10. Once you've completed all of these questions, then the young person can look back at them and decide where their strengths are and if there are any areas that they maybe need to do a bit of development work. So back to the menu. Legal matters and finance, as I said earlier, are intentionally brief and they provide a starting point for helping the young person to think further about this. So for instance, in managing finances, we're asking them again to think of all the things that they think they will need to spend money on in the future. And when they've done that, we ask them to categorize all of these things into things that they maybe want to have and things that they're going to need. So we encourage them to get deeper. Section 10 is on independent travel. Now, this is a key area for a lot of young people. If they can't travel on their own, then actually being able to do anything independently in the future is going to be a challenge for them. We start by asking them for a range of ways of traveling to name whether or not that's something they've done with support. Is that something they've done on their own? Do they think they could do that on their own in the future? And we then move on from that to thinking about, let's take one of those methods of travel. If you were going to learn to do that on your own, how do you think we would plan that out? And there's the opportunity to really look together at what they would need to do to be able to travel independently using whatever mode of transport you've chosen. We then go on to moving on, thinking about who's going to help them, what they're going to do. This is where we're starting to set some of these targets and think about definite action. A key point here is that there will be information about the young person that's going to be relevant to the future. But we've got to remember this is their information. So we start by brainstorming all the things that might be important to share with other people. But we don't assume that they're going to be happy to do that. So for things that they've named, maybe they say, I'm dyslexic. We'll choose that and discuss together, what are the advantages of telling people you're dyslexic? What are the disadvantages of telling them? And then what are the advantages of not telling them? What are the disadvantages of not telling them? When we've got that big picture, we can make an informed decision on whether or not the young person is happy to share that information. And so we then come back to that list and compile something that the young person can use to share with other people, things that they're happy to let them know about themselves. And so then, after doing all of that, we come to the summary where we reflect back on the whole journey and we put together a summarizing document. There's a template that you can download, and that's going to take you to the end of the activities, basically. So at the end of all of this, the young person will end up with a brief document that summarizes what they want for themselves, what their skills are, what they want to share with other people about themselves, and they can use that in whatever way they wish to inform their transition planning. You've also, of course, been through this whole process together, which has hopefully been affirming and encouraging for the young person. So I hope you found that gallop through the resource interesting and helpful. With 40 activities, there's absolutely no way we can go into much depth or even show you all of them. But the resource is available online. It's at mindroom.org. If you go to the resources tab on the homepage, you will find further information about it there and the opportunity to register so that you can download it. We ask people to register because the resource is made freely available. It helps us keep track of how it's being used. As well as providing the resource, my role is also to work one-to-one with students. I do this in partnership with schools. So if you're working in a school and there are young people that you think might benefit from somebody working with them, looking at Future Me together and formulating ideas about what they want for the future, then please do get in touch. I'd be very happy to hear from you. I'll give you my contact details in a moment. We provide advice and support as well to anybody who's using the resource. So once you've registered and downloaded it, if you have feedback, if there are questions that you have, again, please do get in touch and we'll be very happy to help in whatever way we can. And then a reminder that all of this is available at no cost. So the resource itself, my work in schools, and the advice and support that we give is all totally free of charge. If you'd like to get in touch, then my email address is andrew@mindroom.org. And like I said, I would be very pleased indeed to hear from you. And a reminder there of the website, that's mindroom.org. You'll find Future Me, as well as a host of other resources that we have made available. So thank you very much for taking the time to watch this video and to learn a little bit more about Future Me. I hope you found it helpful and interesting, and that you'll go to the website and have a look for yourself. Thank you very much.